boot camp for, I think it was 6 weeks plus 1 week. I was on the USS One, DE-25, and it was one of the older DEs. And so that was one of the reasons that we never got out into combat. But it was only, I think it was about 150 feet long and about 30 feet wide at the widest point there. And that isn't very large as far as ship's concerned. We had about 125 people on it.
Destroyer escorts were between 290 and 308 feet in length. The weight varied from 1,140 to 1,450 tons unloaded, and 300 tons more when fully loaded. There was a range of 180 to 220 officers on one escort. Destroyer escorts were more maneuverable and had a much smaller turning circle compared to destroyers.
Our maximum speed was about 20 knots. We didn't usually travel that fast, maybe 12, 13, 14 miles an hour. It was about as fast as we traveled. And that was quite fast. Convoys wouldn't travel that fast.
Typically, destroyer escorts would travel at a speed of 25 to 35 knots. However, during World War II, destroyer escorts would travel at a slow speed of 10 to 12 knots in order to operate a convoy. These slow speeds enabled destroyer escorts to detect, chase down, and attack submarines, which traveled at 3 to 6 knots when submerged and 22 knots when surfaced.
And the convoys would steer a zigzag course. By that I mean they wouldn't have a straight line course wherever they were going. They'd zigzag so that the submarine wouldn't be able to determine just where they were going to be at a certain particular time. And so the convoy would steer a zigzag course, and the escort ships would have to steer a course in front of that zigzag. So we were zigzagging all over the place. And you could look back and there'd be ships several wide, as far as you could see just about sometimes. All kinds of different ships. I trained to become a sonar operator.
Sonar is an acronym for sound, navigation, and ranging. It is a device that operates on energy to locate objects and determines the distance, direction, size, speed, and location, which then generates a picture of it on the map. All of this works because the way sound waves travel underwater.
If the object is standing still, there's no pitch change. There's no Doppler change. It's the same, the echo sounds the same as the pitch that's sent into the water. But if the object is moving away, the sound wave is enlarged, and so your pitch is lower. Pitch is lower, so you listen to the pitch. And if it's coming towards you, the sound wave is contracted, and so the pitch is higher. And the reason that I was sent to West Coast Sound School, because I was able to determine pitch. Because that's one of the main things then in becoming a sonar operator.
The United States first used sonar systems in 1927 and was kept secret until World War II. Both U.S. and British naval fleets used sonar to attack German U-boats, also known as submarines, before they could be seen above water. There are two types, active sonar and passive sonar. Passive sonar only receives underwater sounds, whereas active sonar is able to send out and receive signals. It uses a transducer which translates electrical signals into acoustics, so when sound waves hit an object, the waves are reflected back and picked up by a receiver. The receiver passes them through a transducer, which changes the sound back into electrical signals. After it goes through this process, these sounds are made evident to an observer through headphones, a record chart, loudspeakers, and cathode ray tubes. Sonar establishes the distance of an object by echo ranging. This works by measuring the amount of time it takes for sound waves to travel from the transducer, reflect off the object, and back to the receiver. Underwater sound travels at a speed of 1 mile per second.
One of the jobs I had was I was in charge of the bathothermograph. And that was an instrument that you let down into the water. It was on a long cable, long small cable, it was the aircraft cable, we called it. Real small steel cable, but it was a fish-like thing, about a foot and a half long. And I put in a smoke slide, but it was a gold slide. And in it, there was a stylus that marked the depth of the water and the temperatures that went down. And so you could determine the temperature of the water as that went down. And I'd let out about, maybe 1,000 feet of cable to let it go down as the ship was going. And I'd bring that back up and take the stylus out, and I'd send that in so that they could determine. And from that stylus, you could determine the distance you could range, or distance the sound wave would go. Because if the water was mixed up good, and the temperature at the top of the water is higher, is warmer than the lower, but sound travels faster in warmer water than it does in cold water, but it travels faster in denser water than it does in the less dense. And so if it's mixed up good, your sound wave would be quite straight, quite long. But if it wasn't, the sound wave could move up, bend up, or it could move back, bend down, depending on. And so that was why you took the temperature of the water, to see how far you could actually sound, how far your sound would actually be accurate.
After the U.S. was able to locate a submarine, they would fire depth charges to attack the enemy submarines. They would fire them off in a special pattern that was called a mousetrap or a hedgehog. A mousetrap meant there were two launching racks, and each rack consists of four bombs plus 33 pounds of TNT. A 60-pound rocket propelled the charges that would fall in an elliptical pattern and armed as they fell through the water. Hedgehogs were virtually the same, just larger versions of mousetraps.
And if one of them hit, it'd explode them all. But if, and you had a pattern, a depth charge pattern. Now those depth charges were just like a little barrel, about a 30-gallon barrel, that was full of explosives. It had a timing, had a device on it, so that when it got down into the water so far, the pressure of the water would explode it. But you could determine, you could set the pressure, then the depth that you wanted to explode.
Destroyer escorts have been described as fairly spacious until the actual crew was on board. The place where sailors would sleep wasn't necessarily called a room, but just an area of the ship, sectioned off, that was three bunks deep. There was approximately 22 inches between each bunk, and the mattresses were about an inch and a half thick. Every mattress had two blankets and no sheets, just a cotton bag that fit over the actual mattress.
Well, they're in the Navy, they're called heads. H-E-A-D, head.
The crew on destroyer escorts had to become accustomed to reasonably small spaces.
When you go to sleep, it was warm, it was hot, and there was a fan in the compartment, and you turn that fan on you. But then when it got colder, you turn the fan off, but then again in the morning, the fan would be back on you because someone else had turned on you.
Every sailor had their own personal locker space that was 2 feet high, 2 feet wide, and 18 inches deep.
But you served all night and all day, you know, it served around the clock on your watches, so you slept when you could. It was a valuable experience. I enjoyed the experience. It was good to have. But as far as unless I was needed for something, I wouldn't just volunteer.